I did a project with John Batiste, which we recorded a meditations album. And the way that I would describe it sounds like something that I would never want to listen to. But if somebody's like, oh yeah, it's like kind of jazz meditations, that sounds like something I would never, ever want to listen to if somebody told me that that's what the album was. So I don't say that. Here, I just did. But
that's what I wouldn't say, that I, you know, that thing I said.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. I what I will say is what I would never say.
Hey everybody, welcome to Hang In, Hang Out, brought to you by the wonderful folks at ENO and Sierra Nevada Brewing Company. I'm Sierra Hull, your host, and I'm so stoked about today's episode. I've got one of the greatest guitarists out there, one of the most energetic musicians I've seen in a long time, and somebody that I've only recently gotten to know a little bit. So I'm super excited to talk to him today, and recently got to play on a new record of his, and it was just so fun, and I can't wait. Give it up for Cory Wong. Cory, how you doing, my friend?
What is up, internet? What is up, Sierra? How are you doing?
Man, I'm good. I'm good, all things considered, in this crazy year that we're living in. But complaints. I'm so thrilled that we have ways like this to connect and stoked to get to talk to you.
Yes, me too. And I am bummed that I did not wear my striped shirt because you wore one for the occasion. I totally messed up. I'm supposed to be stripes guy.
I mean, first things first, I was thinking, what am I going to wear this morning? And I really didn't put a lot of forethought into this until all of a sudden I looked in my drawer and there glaring out at me was a Cory Wong shirt, which I never really realized was a Cory Wong shirt until today. And I was like, I have a Cory Wong shirt and I got to wear it. So yeah
I like that.
For those of you who don't know, this is Corey's signature look, really, the stripes, you know?
Yes. And I do appreciate, my kind of striped shirt is the one where the stripes are even. Sometimes it's like, okay, I look at it like music. I look at my striped shirts like music. To me, you're wearing a little more of the 32nd note or the 16th note triplet shirt. I normally like the 16th note shirt. Some people have the 8th note shirt. Some people have the quarter note shirt. But I do like the evenly spaced stripes. It's more of the grid, you know.
Well, so you know, this wasn't going to be my first question to you. But as I decided to wear my Cory Wong outfit, I was like, I got to know the story on this, you know, the Cory Wong signature look. So I feel like, you know, 9 times out of 10, when I see you performing, that's your look, man. So give us the scoop.
Well,
what's the scoop? When did that start?
There's not a huge scoop involved. I mean, I think it's, you know, it might be maybe it's the Raisin Bran two scoops. You know, there's one scoop is I was a huge Pat Metheny and Maroon 5 fan growing up. James Valentine being a striped shirt guy, Pat Metheny striped shirt guy. Maybe it was just some inherent thing there. Okay, we take the second scoop is I felt like I just needed a wardrobe, a look, a thing. So that way, when I put this thing on, I'm in character. So sometimes, like when I'm on tour especially, I have a tour wardrobe that when I put it on, it feels like this is my outfit.
Like,
now I'm here to go. I'm showing up for work. And then it just turned out that I acquired about 15 or 16 striped shirts.
I was going to ask how many you have.
Yeah, it just kind of became a thing. And then you know, it's kind of fun to treat myself as a character, as an artist. And in a similar way where you see cartoon characters or characters in a show, like a cartoon character is pretty much always wearing the same thing. It's kind of fun to build a character
Yeah, no, I think sometimes like what you said about having something that you put on that's like your stage clothes, you end up feeling like, okay, now I'm ready to go get in the zone and play a show rather than just kind of like you walk on stage in the same thing you've been wearing all day. Like somehow that, I don't know, that doesn't quite give the shift. So I hear you. I
Yeah.
hear you. But yeah, I'm
Yeah,
next
sometimes we
time
need
that
that.
we, I say next time when we finally get to play together in person, I'll have to pack the old striped shirt.
That's it.
Quite the solo career in the last few years, and so many people will probably know you from that and being a fan of your guitar playing and songwriting, and you have like a slew of really fun and cool YouTube videos out there that I know a lot of people have grown accustomed to loving searching for and going down the Cory Wong rabbit hole. But then they also probably know you from your work with Wolfpack as well. And so I thought it'd be fun to just kind of talk about how you got into all this and what has sort of led to, you know, Cory Wong now being a solo artist and collaborating with Wolfpack. In addition to that, I just feel like you're somebody that seems to have all these different things going on, producer, and it would just be fun to kind of hear how you started up. I know you grew up in the Midwest, and we can kind of dive into talking about this after, but your new project that I got to be part of was kind of inspired a little
Yeah.
bit about growing up there. So I thought it'd be fun to just kind of hear how you got into playing music and when you decided this is for me, this is what I'm gonna do.
Sure. So I grew up as like a punk and ska kid, and I loved punk music. I loved alternative rock music, and Red Hot Chili Peppers were my favorite band. And then, then I got into the punk thing and then more of like the acoustic thing. And when I was in college, it was all about Dave Matthews Band, much like many people my age who were in college at basically, I don't know. It seems like Dave Matthews is this universal. When you go to college, you like Dave Matthews and whatever. So
Totally.
I went to school at the University of Minnesota, was going to do science, whatever that, I was going to do science, whatever that means. And I was gonna do science. Then eventually I realized this is cool, this is fun, but it doesn't feel like it's my calling. And so many of the people around me were just like, look, just go to school for music. This is what like brings you joy. This is what brings other people joy that are around you. It seems pretty obvious. This is what you're meant to do in life. And I got my start by playing a lot of cover bands, wedding bands, function bands, whatever you call them. And actually, since I was in middle school, I had a band from the time I started playing guitar when I was 12. And I had this little Boss BR-8 recorder because I wanted to record our band and figure out how to like make a CD, you know? And I guess it was from the time I started, I was learning how to produce, how to record, how to do all that sort of thing. Like, how come it sounds like garbage when there's only one microphone across the room? Like, how come I don't hear my guitar loud enough and all we hear is cymbals? And, you know, learning how to place microphones, learning how to mix tracks a little bit in this little recorder. I've been doing that since I was in middle school. And once I got into playing music professionally, then I started producing albums, some of them really fun projects to work on, some of them just for learning the craft and trying to figure out mm-hmm. how to do the thing better. And eventually started playing for some other artists and touring as a sideman and still writing and producing a lot on my own, just kind of on my spare time, not necessarily as a job. And then eventually started playing with some of the guys in Wolfpack. We became friends, started basically Jack absorbed me into the band. There was no official, there was no engagement or wedding. It was just like, oh, all of a sudden we're in this, what do you call it when you're not actually married, but you've lived together for 10 years, you're like legally bound.
Like a common law marriage.
Yeah. That's it.
Like, you have a common law marriage with Wolfpack.
Yeah. It just like, yeah. That's the term. I just was absorbed into the band. And then from there, Jack really inspired me to start doing a lot more of my own thing. And then all of us in the band have our own projects as well, which is really fun. It breathes life. That the band breathes life into each of our individual endeavors, and our individual endeavors really help breathe new life into the band and our side project, the Fearless Flyers. And it all kind of, when anything does well, it all helps the common good of the whole community in it. So it's really fun. That's when I started doing my own thing. So maybe a few years ago, I felt like, oh, I think I have something to say musically. And I feel like I'm finding my voice, not just on the instrument, but as far as musically and what I want to say as a person. So, you know, I was having a hard time finding, what do I want to say on my instrument? How do I find my voice on the instrument? And then it was like, ah, no, I need to think bigger than that, because I'll just get roadblocked and then just start thinking about the actual fingers and shapes, right? So it was, okay, yeah. Not just on the instrument, what do I want to say with music? Okay, now I'm getting somewhere. And I was starting to think about the sort of things that I wanted to do. But then it was, I don't know, then I have to kind of define a genre, I have to define instrumentation, I have to define this and that, which is fine, that's cool. And I have my own, you know, tendencies for that. But then I was thinking, okay, now that I'm getting this bigger picture thing, I think I need to step up and think even bigger than that. So it was beyond music, is just like, what's a general vision of what I want to say as a person, and what's a general guiding light or guiding principle that can funnel then everything down, which for me was just joy and fun. So how do I use that as my guiding light? That can manifest itself in any form of art, which in my case is music. And within music, that's still a broad spectrum. So for me, it funnels down to mostly guitar and bass. I was just looking at some pictures from touring because I was getting sentimental and thinking, oh my gosh, I want to get back out on the road.
I know, it's been so long.
Yeah, I needed to be reminded of the experience. So I was looking, I have this little folder of cities that I've played in, and looking back 3 years ago when I first started, like, this is the first time we're going out on the road, and playing in Chicago at this little club called the Tonic Room, and there was 100 people there. And then looking back on this last winter in February when I was out on the road at Thalia Hall, where it's like, you know, 1,000 people there. It's like, oh my gosh, I can't believe how much this has grown. What a pleasure and what a blessing it is. And how fun is it that, like, because of, you know, the stuff that's been going on, it's been able to grow this much. So it's been really fun. And I feel like that's a big part of what I do and why I do what I do. It's not, you know, of course there's some sense of like, oh, it's fun that I'm able to do these things on my instrument. And of course I strive for technical excellence and musical excellence in what I do. But the bigger picture thing, the joy and fun part is a thing that, that really for me makes me feel like there's a success.
So back in March, the world kind of shut down and I was just at the beginning of an album release tour. So I was on the road and I had a show in Knoxville, Tennessee, at least not too far from Nashville with my band and crew. But we were just starting a really long stretch of dates when I got a call from my manager and he says, hey, look, the show tonight is happening. But after that, you guys are coming home. The next couple weeks of shows have been canceled. So we played the show that night. We came on home back to Nashville. And I remember waking up the next morning and kind of feeling like I'm probably going to be home for a while. So this was the first piece I wrote when the lockdown started. And it felt only right to call it Unfamiliar Times.
It was kind of these improvised sessions. And the idea was that it's where he and I had these kind of guitar and keyboard, guitar and piano duets that we were kind of playing through in the green room at the Late Show with Colbert, because he's the band leader there. And I was playing a lot in the house band when the show was recording its regular thing. And then we decided, let's add a couple other elements and just record this thing. Let's just have some jumping points. So we have these six tunes that are just jumping points, and then we'll completely improvise from there. No agenda involved. Let's just record the thing. And then we did it. We just recorded the album literally straight down, three nights in a row. It's a 30-minute album. Tuesday night, we record the all six songs straight through, no stopping. Wednesday night, same exact thing. Thursday night, same exact thing. So the sessions were like an hour, 20 minutes of us hanging out, talking, 30 minutes of us recording the thing, 10 minutes of, all right, that was fun. What are you guys doing tomorrow? Sort of thing. And, right, and we just totally did that three nights in a row. And most of it was, three of the songs are from the first night. Three of them are from the third night. For whatever reason, we didn't use anything from the second night. Whatever. Anyway, so that's the thing that John Batiste and I did. Didn't really have a huge plan for releasing it, but it just felt like it felt right to do. And it was just a fun, fun thing to be able to like, here's this kind of piece of art, rather than, all right, we're, you know, we're going to give the big commercial push on this one. You know, it wasn't that.
Right.
Like I was saying, a big part of why I didn't want to just define myself through my instrument or through a genre or through music in general was I wanted to explore what the concept of joy and fun could be in a different setting. So I started writing a bunch of acoustic music. You can't see it right now. I'm by all of my electric instruments, but that side of the room is my acoustic instruments. And I'm not normally with those when I'm on the road. So a few different acoustic guitars, my classical guitar, my mandolin, my ukulele, they're just not with me on the road. I normally have a couple Stratocasters and then that's it. But since I was here, I wanted to explore some kind of different writing, different recording. And I was going for a lot of walks, and I live in just outside of Minneapolis. And, you know, there's some great nature. We have a lot of lakes here in Minnesota. There's a lot of really nice kind of forest areas, nature preserve areas just close to my house. And even in my backyard, just having some trees and a fire pit, that's really nice to just be around and just get out in the yard and sit and reflect and just soak in the sounds of the natural world, you know, the sounds of the earth. And as weird as, you know, I don't know, I don't mean to sound really wooey on that, but, you know, just to soak in.
No, but I totally relate to what you're saying. I think you spend so much time traveling and sort of the hustle and bustle of that, that to be able to like actually have a moment of peace, like sitting outside, not sitting in a studio or a theater, you know, just to actually be outside and nature, it can be hugely inspiring and sort of give you life as a musician. It does me too.
Yeah. So I was reflecting a lot, and then I started writing a bunch of acoustic music, and then I wrote more and more. And then I realized, oh, this kind of like feels like two different things. It feels like contemplative, reflective music. And then it feels like the fun, still kind of what you would expect out of a Cory Wong album, but on acoustic instruments. So I split those up into two albums, Trail Songs, Dusk and Dawn. Dusk being more of the chill, reflective. Dawn being more of like going about your day, your daytime, you know, thing. So it was really fun. And I asked you to play on Dawn on that album. There's a tune called Western Winds that I was just like, I could play the lead stuff on this, but like you're saying, when you're on the road, sometimes you're just doing your own thing so much and it's just so much of you. For me, I don't always want to hear guitar. I'm a guitar player. I love the guitar, but I do not always want to hear guitar. And then I sat down with my mandolin. I was like, all right, I'm gonna see if I could play on this. I'm like, no, this is not happening. And I was remembering back to hanging with Eddie Barbash, our mutual friend, and he was like, oh my gosh, I've been playing with Sierra Hull. She's a shredder. Dude, she is so insane. He was going off. He was going off about how amazing you were on mandolin. He's showing me your Instagram. He's like, you got to check her out. I'm like, okay.
Oh, so
I was sitting there with
good
my,
old Barbash.
Well, actually, let me show you.
Okay.
Actually, I have a mandola. It's not a mandolin because.
Oh yeah, sweet.
I need bigger frets because, you know, I'm a guitar person, and it's easier for me to play mandola than mandolin. I gotta get it. You know, you get all this tight.
You, an octave mandolin too.
I like that. That would be awesome.
Even bigger.
Maybe a little, even easier to play. So I was just thinking about it. And then I literally, as I was sitting with this mandola in my hands, it's like, I don't want to play on this. I can't do this. Who can I get to do this? Ooh, Sierra. I'm sitting here, right here. I'm sending you a message on Instagram like, hey, blah, 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 this and this. Will you play on my song? And here we are now. So,
oh man, well, I was super stoked. Like I said, I know we've had mutual friends for a long time, so I knew a little bit about you and your music, and you know, was a fan of what I'd heard. So I was like, oh yeah, sure, that'd be fun. And I just had a blast getting to play on it. Super fun to get to play mandolin in the context of a track like that. You know.
Oh my gosh, you crushed it. So this is kind of the perfect time of year in Minnesota. I'm from the Midwest. This is where I grew up and where I still live. Weather-wise, the coming months are going to be awful, but right now it's kind of this perfect night. And for me, when I connect to music, when I connect to the earth, a lot of times I like to just come outside and spend some time in nature and reflect, contemplate things. And sometimes musically what I'm chasing is something where there's always something exciting. Oh, it's this thing going to a next thing, and it's this thing that leads with these different energy arcs and that sort of thing. And the music guides the emotional context of something, and everything else is the backdrop. But I put together this little tune, which is basically just a mantra musically. It's just something that I play basically the same way the whole time. I kind of shift tone a little bit here and there, but the thing that moves is the environment around me. And I think it's a good exercise for me, and it's a good reflective exercise and just human thing for me to do, to be able to just play something, sit in something, and take in the surroundings as the thing that's moving, rather than me always being the one that's moving in my surroundings. So I'll play this little thing I call Teardrops. Thank you.
What's your process like from the time you dream up an idea to actually creating the idea to deciding to let other people hear it?
So historically, it's been, I'm going to do an album every year. And it's just like, this is, I'm going to work on an album. This is the album for 21. This is the album for 20, 19, 18, 17, whatever year. And that's kind of how Wolfpack has operated. And when we started the Fearless Flyers, same sort of thing. Like, we're going to release one project every year. But this year, it's just been kind of, I don't know, I've got this idea. I'm going to start recording this music. Oh, okay. Feels like I'm pretty close. I got 10 songs together. And for me, I mix a lot of my own music. So I do a lot of mixing and mastering myself, just because I've done it for a long time. Sometimes I know that I'm too tunnel visioned and I'll get somebody else to do it. And I'm not I don't consider myself the greatest mixer in the world, but I will put more time into mine than anybody else will because I care more, rightfully so.
Sure. Totally.
So I'll spend a lot of time and I can get it exactly where I want it. But this year I've just kind of decided I'm doing the album, and then all I need is 2 weeks to upload it to my digital distribution and then let people know. I don't know. Sometimes what I've liked doing is just, maybe I'm doing this the wrong way, but I just tell people the day that it's out, because then there's a call to action.
Yeah.
You know, I don't know. It's fun to tell people that something's coming and build anticipation, but it's also kind of fun to just say, hey, here's this thing. It's out. Go look at it right now.
It's like, it's what Beyonce does. It's what Taylor Swift does. Why shouldn't Cory Wong do it, man?
Well,
it's like, here it is. Mic drop.
I'm not selling out stadiums, and I don't have billions of followers. So, you know, maybe, I don't know. What's your philosophy on release strategy? What's been your thing?
Well, I've been very slow to make records, and that's something that part of why I'm asking this is because it's something that I want to be more proactive, and I feel like sometimes I can hold myself back from feeling like I'm not ready, you know, yeah. Rather than just kind of being down and excited about whatever's exciting me in the moment and doing it and going, cool, this excites me now. Here's this thing, or here's this little piece. Like, I have all these projects and things that I've sort of been thinking about and had in the back of my head for a long time that I still haven't done. And this time has sort of been a good opportunity for me to just start thinking about, you know, in the future, what those things look like and what things I want to work on. And so typically I've kind of went, okay, I've put out a record and then I've toured it. And in some cases waited 4 to 5 years to put anything out. I've never stopped touring, but I've really like taken large gaps of time in between, you know, my solo projects.
So because I'm not doing a lot of stuff with lyrics or singing, I feel like it's a little bit easier for me to be more prolific in my writing and recording and releasing of things, because there's so much nuance when it comes to language, spoken language, and the human voice. There is something that takes a lot more time and care with that. So I think for me, I do have an advantage that I'm not doing as much vocal music, but also what I've noticed, and I don't know where you sit on this, but I feel like my best music always comes from the most instinctual, rather than like what you're saying, the phrase you said, getting in your own way. Sometimes if I'm mulling over something over and over again, all of a sudden I overanalyze everything. It's like, oh, is this really a great form? You know, and then, I mean, sometimes it's good to go over that, but if I'm spending months going over that on one song, it's like, sometimes I just get in my own way on that, where if you look at my Spotify top 10 songs, they're all tunes that just came to me, and it's like, all right, this is the thing, and I'm going to do it, and here's the thing, and blah, 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 and we go. And they come out, and they're their own thing, and I didn't get in the way of the process, so it just ends up being better, and it allows me to be a little more prolific. If you look at the expectation of a musical artist, you release an album, every 1 or 2 years, right? And if you look at other forms of art and think about other artists like Monet, Picasso, or Stephen Colbert, or Lorne Michaels with Saturday Night Live, there are so many works of art that they put out in a given year where it's like Saturday Night Live does what, 40-ish episodes a year? The Late Show, they do, you know, if it's a couple hundred shows a year, and I'm expected to only release 10, 15 songs a year or every 2 years.
I think that's part of what at times as an artist has made me slow to make records, is feeling like, okay, you have this one moment in time that feels like you've got to get it all out. You've got to say everything that you've had pent up for the last few years, and it has to really like mean this thing. And it sort of like feels like you have this one moment to make a speech rather than feeling like you're having a constant conversation with your fans, which, you know, I love the album art form, and part of me gets sad when I think about that kind of meaning less and less in the way people consume music today. Because I've always, you know, it's the thing. I grew up staring at album covers and going, I want to be just like my heroes, and that's what I want to do. And, you know, kind of daydreaming about the experience of making albums that way. But I do think, like, as we move more into a streaming digital format where you are kind of, in some ways, people expect you to roll out music a little bit more than maybe they used to. I don't know. I'm starting to think about it. Well, how can I have a constant conversation? You know, as in some ways, maybe I've been reluctant to want to embrace that. But the more I think about it, it sort of starts to feel exciting to think about not having to, like, you know, put so much pressure on myself to like take the time to wait till I have this thing to say, rather than going, well, I feel like I always have something to say. I'm just not allowing myself to always say it. So
this next song is one that I wrote late last year. I recorded it on my album that came out at the beginning of this year, and little did I know that playing this song would sort of take on a whole new meaning in 2020. This is called Everybody's Talking. Tell myself, should time forget? take it day by day. One step, then another, until I discover the road I'm supposed to take.
For people who have been a fan of your music already, I know they've got to be stoked for 2020 and all that you're putting out there into the world. And especially with just, you know, this crazy time, we all need some joy. So I definitely think you're doing an amazing job of putting that into the world. And of course, I want people to also check out your podcast. You have a podcast. That's really great.
Yes, and I got to get you on it.
I'd love it. Yeah, for sure.
I got to get you. I have so many questions for you. And how you got so good at what you do, but we'll save it for that podcast.
We'll talk for sure. And then, of course, you know, people can find you online. You've got a lot of fun YouTube videos. I've personally enjoyed the ones where you kind of break down the sessions on the one. That's what it's called, I think.
Yeah.
And you kind of go behind the scenes and pull up the sessions and show people different things about the projects you're working on. If people are interested in that and want to get a deeper look inside of that, and of course they can find you online of social media and all that fun stuff to find out when you're dropping your next project.
Yeah.
But thanks for talking with me today.
Of course. Thanks so much for having me. It's really fun
to hang out.
Hang and talk to you. Yeah.
Absolutely. And of course, big thanks to folks at ENO and Sierra Nevada for creating this space where we can have this hangout session, and also helping create awareness for the Sweet Relief Musicians Fund, which is one of the things that makes me proud to be a part of this. The Sweet Relief Musicians Fund is helping all kinds of musicians in need during this crazy time. And their COVID fund is helping take care of the folks out there that we love that need it the most. And if people want to donate for that, they can go to sweetrelief.org. Cory Wong, I hope we'll get to do this in person sometime, as well as play some music. Thanks again for being my guest today. And I'll be excited to see what you do next.
Awesome. Thank you. Thanks so much for having me.
Thanks so much.
Peace. And you need to teach me how to play this thing at some point.
Hey man, if you'll teach me the awesome funk rhythm, you know.
All right, it's a deal. We'll trade. I like it.
Sounds good.